Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
That was great. First of all, I would like to thank each one of you for being here today on such an important day for the city of New Bedford. I also would like to thank every volunteer that has made this such a great event so far. I do have to say I am a little emotional looking outside and seeing all of you here participating with your posters, which means that we're leading to a lot more than what we thought. We also want to thank all the city officials, the police department, but most of all, we want to thank those that are no longer with us here. That's the reason why we're here. So today we celebrate, and I want to say celebrate, those we have lost to overdose. It's called International Overdose Awareness Day. It is a day that many began to celebrate throughout the state, throughout the world, until August 31st. What I want you to remember is that we should celebrate this day every day so we can bring awareness to the people that are suffering and those we have lost. Today is about those that struggle with addiction and they were not able to survive. Today, it's honoring those that had an addiction and they could not get through to become clean, to be in a recovery, to be in the right path. Today we honor their sacrifice and we honor their addiction so that we can make a better tomorrow. As a city, we're standing here today telling each and one of you that we are a city of one. We are here to help each other. We are here for that person that's sitting behind a desk and struggling with addiction. We are here for their mother who's in the kitchen table crying because they can't find their loved one and they wonder if they have overdose. Amen. We are here for those who are struggling in a detox or a sober house. And we are also here for a city that continues to strive to eliminate, to educate, to bring prevention so that we don't have to stand here anymore other than stand here for victory, that we no longer have to bring awareness.
Thank you.
So I ask of you, this goes beyond our city here. You have to be advocates. You have to be the power that goes up to the state house and advocate for our city. You are the mentors, you are the messengers. We need each and one of you to advocate for a healthier city, We can all work together, but we can't work together without your voice. Your voice is crucial as we advocate to bring more services to our city, as we advocate to have more detoxes, as we advocate to have stigma removed so that we can be their hand for that person who's struggling. We will continue to fight that there is no reason why someone cannot ask for help because they're stigmatized because they're suffering from an addiction. We will not tolerate that. We as a group want you to advocate for people who are struggling so that we don't have to bury our sisters, our brothers, our parents, our children. We need to become the voice of those who are continue to struggle and the voice of those we have lost. Hope is not something that we let go as a group. Hope is something that we don't let go of their mother who's in the kitchen table right now struggling because they can't get their child into service. Hope is what we're doing right here, right now. Every human being deserves to have hope. Every human being deserves to have a hand pull them out of where they're at. And that's what we are. We are the city of one that is always going to have their hand to help out someone who suffers from addiction. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Reverend David Lima. I'm with the Interchurch Council, part of the Bedford Opioid Task Force, and a variety of other things. And that was Connie Rocha Mimosa. You're going to put that down a little bit. That was Connie Rocha Mimosa, who was only going to speak for 2 minutes. And now I get to introduce all the government officials who are supposed to only speak for 2 minutes. We're going to give the mayor 3. But you got to help me time this, okay? All joking aside, we're here for something serious. We're here because so many of us know somebody. In fact, if you know someone, lost someone yourself, or you know somebody who's lost their lives to overdose, or are struggling, please raise your hand. Okay? I'm not sure if anybody out there is not raising their hand, but I think it's about everybody has. The thing is it does touch every part of our community, is across the nation. This is an epidemic that is just overwhelming. And our numbers are down, and we're supposed to celebrate that, and we should when it's trending in the right direction. But we still lost almost 2,000 people last year. Almost 2,000 in the state of Massachusetts. We lost over 50 people in the city of New Bedford. You know, that's a bus crashing and everybody dying. We'd be mourning like no tomorrow about, you know, that kind of accident. And this is happening, and the struggle is real. And so we're here to talk about that. So I'm gonna pray for about 1 second, maybe two, and then we're going to have a few people speak. Then we're going to process down to Pilgrim United Church of Christ, where we'll have a service where there will be a guest speaker who's lost someone that was close to her. And we encourage you to join us, tell your story, speak to one another, because that's how we overcome the shame and the stigma. That's how we overcome the difficulty of people not being able to talk to one another. And you might say, well, what is it that I can do? You know, Connie mentioned going to Boston. That's not me. That's not what I am. But I'll tell you what you can do. You can love people. You can care about people. You can offer your hand in friendship. You can tell people that there's hope. And they may not feel it. They may not even understand it right away. But the thing is if all of us are doing it, sooner or later, it gets through. And we can help save lives. Amen? Let's bow our heads for a second. Lord, we just ask your presence be here, not only during this time as we speak now, but even as we process in the service that's coming. Father God, we lift up to you memories of every single person who's lost their lives, not only this past year, but years previous. And Father, we just ask that you would help us, strengthen us, help us to love one another, and help us to strengthen the families that are here that are hurting because they've lost somebody that they love. Lord, for this, for all things, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to introduce to you the mayor of our city of New Bedford, Mayor Jon Mitchell.
All right, thank you, Reverend Lehman. Thank you, Connie, for that great introduction. It was really the way to kick us off. And I just want to say to both of you, thank you for all that you do, not just on commemoration days like this, but all throughout the year. Because as so many people in this audience know, I can pick out so many of you who have been part of the fight, part of the effort. As all of you know, it is something that we can't relent on at any part of the year. These anniversaries, these commemorations are important. They help sensitize others. But for those of you who've lost somebody, and those of you who are in the fight, you need no reminders. You don't need the 2 minutes or 3 minutes or whatever we government officials might say up here to know that there are plenty of people struggling out there still. We have made great strides in the last couple of years in relative terms, right? The trends are good. 2016 to 2017, fatal ODs went down by about 35% in the city. That's encouraging. But the reality is that there are still some 36 people who fatally overdosed in the city. Still 36. So those are 36 mothers and fathers and sisters and daughters and people we know, people we love. It's too much. One's too much, and we all know, and we can't relent. We don't want any other family to have to get that call after years of struggle. More importantly, we don't want more people to fall prey to this. And that's where the removal of the stigma comes in. We want to help. The city is really hustling. When I say city, I don't just mean the important work that each one of the government officials up here is doing. I mean all of us, the Opioid Task Force and other groups all together know and have been really working hard over the last few years at the proposition that we have to end it all. We have to end it all. We have to catch everybody. And I think we should take confidence in the progress. I think we should take confidence in the fact that, you know, we've been recognized as a city nationally that's doing a really good job at it. But until we've caught everybody, then we can't say that our work is done, and we still have a long ways to go. But know that that work counts. Know the work that you're putting in matters a lot. When we step forward tonight and the next, not just tonight, but the next day and the months afterwards, that work counts a lot. We have to stick with it. I do want to add one programming note. Sean Fitzgerald is throwing an event on Sunday to raise money over at Greasy Luck. I want everybody to stop on by, because I want to say thank you, Sean, for making that happen. It does take money, whether it comes from the state or the city or from the private sector. We've had so many generous folks step up. We need to keep going, and that's a good way to do it. So hopefully we'll see you all there. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Next, I'd like to invite our District Attorney, Thomas Quinn, to come and speak a few words.
Thank you, Reverend Lehman. Connie, in your efforts in this area, I'm here to recognize those who lost their battle with addiction and to support the loved ones who continue to grieve their loss. 2014, there were 122 fatal overdoses in Bristol County. 2017, there were 221. Through July, there's been 120. I read every one of those reports. These are just the fatal overdoses. And I read them because every life matters, and the impact it has on the family members and the victim is very sad to me. But the only way this can be solved is through a cooperative effort from the people you've heard here today, who was mentioned by the speakers. We've implemented some programs to help deal with this issue. We've worked with the mayor and the police department on a lead program that defers prosecution of people with drug addiction to get services if there are certain lower level crimes. We've implemented a hidden in plain sight, which is a mock bedroom where a lot of teenagers hide drugs and conceal them so parents can be more aware of it. We've started the Bristol Alliance with South Coast Hospital to bring all the people involved in this effort together. So we prosecute people who sell fentanyl and traffic. That's part of it. That can't stand it. There's a reason the number of fatal overdoses have gone up, and that's because of fentanyl, which is a very powerful drug that has resulted in the death of many more people. So It's not just about prosecution, it's about a combination of efforts coming together to try to reduce this scourge, and that's what it is across the country, in New Bedford, through this county. So working together, we can make progress. There's a lot of work to do. It's not going to go away, but again, working together is what it's all about. So I want to again thank all those people involved, and we'll continue our effort to work together to address this very serious issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Also, I'd like to invite up, I'll invite them up as a pair. They can decide who's going to speak first. Our New Bedford Opioid Task Force is chaired by two personally great men, as far as I'm concerned. Their heart and their passion in trying to overcome and bring together everybody, because how many people know bringing organizations together to work with one another is like herding cats. Okay, quite frankly, it's like herding tigers. It's not little pussycats. It's everybody does their own thing. Everybody wants to do what they've got to do. And quite frankly, sometimes we're all chasing the same dollar, the same grant. Being able to get people to work together, to understand and share their numbers, to be able to understand the work so that we don't have gaps, is a major effort. And we have two co-chairs for the New Bedford Opioid Task Force, and I'd like to bring them both up. And like I said, they can decide. We'll see who's going to defer to who. But our New Bedford Police Chief, Joseph Cadero, and our Health Department Head, Damone Chapman.
Good afternoon to everyone. Happy to be here with you today. This marks my 19th month here in New Bedford. We've been working diligently, as the pastor has informed you, on implementing systems and programs to help the city of New Bedford deal with this crisis. We've lost many family members and community partners and members along the way, but I'm here to say that the effort is not without vain. It's not in vain. We've come a long way and we're doing great work. The task force, we have begun to implement evaluations of programs, bringing in new partners and new opportunities for the city and for the programs. And so with that, I'm thankful, and I believe that we'll do better together as we go forward.
Thank you, Damone. Well, welcome, everybody. So glad to see so many people here, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here and being committed to what we're trying to deal with, which is an overdose crisis. You know, the mayor talked about, and others have talked about, the great strides that we've made here in the city, and we have, but we still have one major barrier, and I think the mayor started talking about it as well, and that's the stigma of this disease. You know, there's still people out there that think that people choose to live this life. That is crazy thinking. That's ill, sick thinking, and we need to change that thinking before we can get over that barrier. Now, the real question is, how do we do that? And is I want to submit to you, there's one person that can really make that major change here. And, you know, I'm not talking about God, Reverend. I'm not talking about some celebrity. I'm not talking about elected officials. I'm talking about each one of us. We have an opportunity to make an absolute difference in how people think about this disease, to re-educate them, to make them understand that we need to care. You know, for the last 3 years, I've been on the mantra about a city of one. I love to see the shirts that out there. But truly, we are a city of one. If we're gonna make a significant difference, it's gonna require all of us to come together to truly bring this issue to the forefront of people's thoughts and change their hearts and their minds of how they see these individuals that are suffering from disease. We need to change our language. We need to change how we talk about it and what adjectives we use to describe it. And how do we do that? That's every single day, and it's gonna require of all of us to change the energy. There's great synergy in the city, but we need to change the energy and the thoughts and what's in people's hearts. And how we do that is we need to start with love and caring for one another and our neighbors and to educate them. And once we start to do that, we start to change the hearts and the minds and rid this stigma, because it's preventing people from getting help. When they have this stigma, this big dark cloud over their head of people, how we're going to judge them and how we're going to see them and how we're going to think about them and how we're not going to give them another chance of getting a job and progressing with their life, they can't get ahead. And if anybody that knows anybody that suffers from this disease, and I suspect that everybody does because it impacts all of us, then you know what they're carrying and the anchors that's holding them down and progressing. And what we don't need is that stigma. So I thank you for being here today. Connie told me I had 10 minutes. The Reverend told me I got 1 minute. So I wish I could talk more about it. But I want to thank you for being here. We live in a great city. Make no mistake about it. That's why the changes are happening here. That's why our overdoses are down. We've got a lot of work to do, and we require everybody to do their part and to turn it around. So thank you for being here. This is a great city. And I know next year we're going to be further ahead of what we are this year. So thank you very much.
And obviously, we know who the chief listens to when he's going to talk. We have at least a couple of city councilors with us, Brian Gomes and Joe Hopes. I don't know if there's anybody else out there that I haven't seen.
Chris Hendricks.
Chris Hendricks. Oh, he's only a state rep. He's not a city councilor. Don't confuse me there. Okay? It's tough enough. All right? It's tough. This is tough. So I'm going to invite Councilman Gomes, come up here and speak, okay?
Thank you very much, Reverend. This is one of those things that are not very easy. As I approach today, I've seen all the purple. We know what it stands for. And then I've seen a lot of faces. I see tears, I see hurt. We talk about being one. There's no separation on this issue. There's no Republican, Democrat, independent on this issue. This is one issue that has affected all of us, somewhere, somehow, through family, neighbor. It hurts. I see a sign out there that says every overdose matters. You're darn right it does, because somebody is somebody, and it does matter. And together, we can make a difference. Together, we can make a difference. It's been said so many times. We need a little bit of love. A little bit of love, everybody. Love one another. Love those that are hurting. Be there for them. We need a little bit of caring from those that don't quite understand this issue and don't understand how it's affecting the community and affecting their neighbor or one of their loved ones. We have an obligation, all of us, not only those that stand here today, this entire city, to take this on, to clean it, to be there, to touch someone. I got a great love for this city. I love its people. I don't like what happened. Somebody should be held accountable for that. God bless you all for being here this afternoon. Yes, we do stand as one. One city against opiate addiction. Thank you very much.
I'd also like to bring up Representative Chris Hendricks to speak to us, please.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming out here today. I'll make this short and sweet. I got into elected office. I got into being part of the solution. So I was not only my own personal experience with addiction, but I was sick of going to funerals. I was sick of having my friends that I grew up with die left and right. I was sick and tired of the people I went to school with dying left and right. I'm sick of it. Okay? And, you know, this is a tricky issue. You know, we're not going to solve this thing overnight. But there's one thing you can do, and if we need to reverse the stigma on this issue. We can't sit here one day and say it's a human condition and we have your back, but we're gonna throw away innovative ideas to solve this problem. We need to be innovative in doing this thing. We have the New Bedford Opioid Task Force, which the mayor and the chief have done an unbelievable job in doing, in their leadership. So I just want to thank you for that. You know, I was at one of the meetings for the New Bedford Opioid Task Force a week or so ago. They need people. They need boots on the ground. They need volunteers. If there's something that you're thinking about doing and you're not sure if it's going to help, join the Opioid Task Force. Volunteer your time. We need boots on the ground to do this thing. I volunteered myself to work on the recovery subcommittee with Carl Alves. I think that's him. That's right. We need your help on this. You know, call up the police department. Say, I want to help. That's all we're going to need to do this. So thank you for coming out there today. And we need to stick together on this issue. So, you know, solving this as a community is how we're going to do it. You know, we're not going to do this by stigmatizing panhandlers. We're not going to do this by stigmatizing drug addicts. You know, this is a human condition that anybody is susceptible to. You know, we need to take the stigma from the people who made poor decisions in the past. You know, I see a gentleman out there trying to get signatures for a petition to get more awareness for young people. I said, what organization are you with? He said, I'm just here by myself. I lost a son to this disease. That's what we need, that type of leadership. So thank you for coming out here today.
We're going to slip in Councilor Joe Oakes, who's only got 30 seconds to speak, but...
I got 30 seconds?
Yeah.
I will be extremely brief. I know how to count. Everyone that raised their hand that lost a loved one, God bless you and your families for that loss. And I had a really good friend of mine who was a recovering addict before he passed away. And I remember him telling me when he was in recovery that he used to take his keys and he used to throw them. So he would have to pray to find his keys or pray that he would recover. And he would take his keys, and I haven't forgot that story, and he would throw them when he came home so he wouldn't be able to leave his house. That's how deep it can be. So I say, God bless to everyone. As everyone has said, we are a city of one. We're working together. Unity will help and carry us forward. Thank you and God bless for coming out here today.
So we've got one more person that's going to be coming up to speak, Tuesday DeRosha, who lost a son. She will speak, and I'll ask her to make her way up here. While she's making her way up here, I want to give you a picture, okay? A lot of people, when we talk about addiction, when we talk about substance abuse, we always think about the junkie on the corner. We think about the person that's in the alley. Since 2015, this city has had a program where we go out 6 days a week. If you ask the chief, it's six and a half. 6.5 days a week, we go and visit anybody that's overdosed. Anyone that has overdosed in the city, we go and visit them. And we go with a drug resource counselor, a recovery coach. We go with a plainclothes police officer because they're going to offer help. And they go with a chaplain. And it's all about trying to get people connected to services, try to get them into things, try to get them into a place where they can be supported, where they can get the help they need, to try to help the loved ones understand what it is that they can get, how they can be helped so they can understand what their loved one is going through and they can get the support they need. Because if somebody's got a substance abuse, if somebody's in the throes of addiction, the whole family's got an addiction problem. Understand that. And one of the difficulties, the things that we have to deal with is, again, making that awareness so that everybody is free and open to get the help. They'll be able to offer and say, let me in. And somebody's going to be there to say, yes, come on, because we can do something. That's the thing we're trying to do. And I'm going to ask Tuesday now to speak for a few seconds here.
2 seconds.
Minutes. I like Tuesday. She can talk.
Hi, my name is Tuesday, and I lost my son, Caleb Matthew Bethany, 2 years ago. It was March 5th, 2017. This is a time to remember, so I would like to share with you a little bit about my son. Caleb was crazy. He was a daredevil. He was fashion crazy. You name it, he wore it, and he got away with it. And I mean, he would walk around with these, for instance, wolf slippers and a leopard hat and like you know, baggy shirt and dress pants. And he got away with it because he was just so handsome. And, you know, any one of us that might try to wear that, we'd be in trouble. He had no fear. He was happy. He would walk into a room and the whole room would light up. Everybody wanted to be near Caleb because he made you feel important. He made you feel special. He just had such a gift with people. He had such a way to make you feel loved. And he had these hugs that he would give you and you would just get lost in this giant bear hug. He was 6'4", about 220 pounds, and man, when he hugged you, you knew it. And he just brought so much joy to my heart and I was so proud of him. And he began his experiments with drugs, probably in high school. I know he smoked some marijuana and, you know, drank like kids do, but he started to delve into the pills and he became addicted. Percocets, Oxycontin, oxycodone. I watched my son, who was just the golden boy, become this shadow of himself. He became introverted. He became depressed. You know, he would stay in his room for hours and hours, where before, you know, he'd be gone forever. And we'd be like, where you been? Oh, I was with this friend, and I was with that friend, and we did this, and we did that. And I see Cam and Chadwick and Ian and some of his other friends here. And man, he had so many friends, and he was just so excited to be with them. But when he started using the drugs, he didn't want to be with any of us. And so I watched him disappear minute by minute, day by day, and he just shrunk. And it came to a point where we were like, you know, Caleb, it's time. You've got to go get some help. You've got to go to treatment. He went to detox. He went, you know, came back home and started using again. So now he went into a longer program. We really thought that he was going to be okay because whatever Caleb tried, he was so good at. So we're like, you know what? He's going to beat this. This is going to happen. He never ever would have dreamed that he would have died of an overdose. There was no way that was going to happen to him. On, let's see, March 2nd, I got to spend the weekend with him. He came home and we had a great weekend. It was so much fun. He was just hysterical. He was his old self and he was just, you know, happy to be around us again. And it was so good to see him back. I brought him back to the sober house that he was living at in Falmouth. And on March 5th, the phone rang and it was 6 o'clock in the morning. And there's nothing good coming from a phone call at 6 o'clock in the morning. And instantly I knew something horrible had happened. And my husband tried to keep it quiet, you know, and got up and went in the other room. And I got up and I remember just sitting down in the rocking chair and just holding myself together and thinking, oh my God, it's Caleb, something horrible's happened. And just then there was a knock at the door and there was a police officer. And he came in to let us know that our son had overdosed and he had not survived. And there's nothing to prepare you for that. No matter how many times in my head I thought something awful was gonna happen, that was not gonna happen. We had to go through the awful, awful process of going to identify our son. No mother should ever have to do, no one should ever have to do that. We had to pick out his clothes for his funeral. We had to plan his funeral and we did it just like Caleb would have wanted it. It was crazy. He wore bright clothes and we all wore lathes and, you know, we had the music going that he would have listened to. So he was honored that day. He should be here today. And that's why I'm up here talking. That's why our family comes and we go to every event that we can like this, because he would do that. He would be the person to stand up for someone who can't fight for themselves. And he can't fight for himself. And there's so much stigma and he was so ashamed. There's nothing to be ashamed of. We all have something that we're addicted to. We all have something. It may not be drugs, but we all have a struggle. And I just want to thank you so much for being here and for honoring our children and our brothers and our sisters and everyone who's been lost. I look out here and I'm blown away. It does this mama's heart such good to see you all here. So thank you so much for listening.
Thank you so much, Tuesday. So we're going to walk now. We're going to walk down to the church. We're going to sing together, pray together. We're going to hear another testimony. But most of all, this is what I'm going to ask you to do. On the way, I'm going to ask you to talk to somebody you do not know. Okay? We all came with friends, I'm sure. And families do come and they support one another. But I'm going to ask you, let's break the mold. Talk to somebody you don't know. Share your story, listen to their story. Because it's that kind of process that helps us change society. It's that kind of thing where we start to get to know other people and realize, I'm not alone. Didn't this happen to us? Are we ready to do that?
Know that you can watch any of New Bedford Cable Network shows anytime, anywhere, on all of your mobile devices? How, you may ask? Just log on to nbcablenetwork.com and bam! You have all three channels at your fingertips. Public, educational, and government access. Here, you can view our program schedules, watch our channel's live broadcasts, or search for a particular program in our vast library of shows. Last year alone, New Bedford Cable Network produced over 500 shows, and nearly all of them are available online at nbcablenetwork.com. Not only can you stay up to date with what's happening in your local government and schools, but also dive into some of New Bedford Cable Network's original award-winning programs. So check us out at nbcablenetwork.com.